The notion of a worldwide inborn musical grammar has haunted me, but I would never have dreamed of basing a lecture series on a notion so ill-defined and apparently non-verifiable if it were not for the extraordinary materials that have appeared in recent years on the similar idea of a universal grammar underlying human speech. I've been profoundly impressed and encouraged by the burgeoning of thought in this relatively new linguistic area, an area that might be called Chomskyan. By so naming it, I don't mean to restrict my observations to Noam Chomsky's work alone. It's a term of convenience, since he is the best known, most revolutionary, and best publicized name in that area. Along with his colleagues and disciples, many of whom are now in radical disagreement with him, he has produced a body of work that has reinvigorated linguistics to a point where it seems new light may be shed on the nature and structural functions of that elusive thing called mind. In other words, by studying in depth why we talk the way we do, by abstracting the logical principles of language, we may be in a position to discover how we communicate in a larger sense through music, through the arts in general, and ultimately through all our societal behavior. We may even discover how we are mentally constituted, because language is species specific. That is, it's common to all of us who belong to the human species, and only to us. Of course, tomorrow morning, cheerful new facts about dolphins or a certain chimpanzee named Sarah may throw a monkey wrench into the works, but meanwhile, this philosophical science called linguistics seems to have become our newest key to self-discovery. With each passing year, it seems to substantiate ever more convincingly the hypothesis of innate grammatical competence, as Chomsky calls it, genetically endowed language faculty, which is universal. It's a human endowment. It proclaims the autonomy of the human spirit.